Hi everyone, I'll start by introducing myself. I'm Natalie Volan. I'm one of the PEAC officers. And I guess we're gonna start by introducing our panelists today. I'll start from closest to me and go backwards. Queen Harris is a PhD student in applied mathematics at ASU, and she teaches eighth grade competency at the Iman Complex. Next, we have Donna Harati. She's a former education reentry specialist with AmeriCorps and will soon be working with Homeboy Industries. Next, we have Leah Weed. She's an adult basic education instructor and also the Penn Project Director at the Penitentiary of New Mexico. Next is Brett Nunson. He's a lecturer in the School of Mathematical and Statistical Sciences at ASU, and he teaches math at Florence State Prison. Next, we have Sarah Herman. She's a PhD student in social psychology, and she's teaching the first section of Psychology 101 in Florence State Prison. Next is Kevin Wright. He's an assistant professor in the School of Criminology and Criminal Justice at ASU, and he is directing the Inside Out program and the Florence East unit. Next is Gary Garrison. He's a third year MFA student and he teaches creative writing at Florence State Prison. And last but not least, we have Jackie Balderrama. She's a third year MFA student and she also teaches creative writing at Florence State Prison. To get started, out of my own curiosity, and I'm sure everyone else's curiosity as well, can we just go down the line and give a little background information about how you all got started in prison education?
Last summer, can you hear me? Last summer, can you hear me now?
Yeah, closer.
No.
I know you can hear me now. believe it or not, I do teach. I have taught in the past, and one of my big problems initially was, we can't hear you. So with the mic, I'm sure you can hear me now. But last summer, Dr. Al Bogus sent an email to everyone asking people to volunteer to tutor at the prison. And I saw that email, and it just touched me. Just something about it just touched me, so I thought, I'm going to respond to this email and tutor at the prison. So I did, and that's how I got started. And there were online courses to take, and then we met at the prison to have a little further training. And then I don't regret one day of everything I had to do to get to the point where I am now.
Wonderful, thank you.
So I started doing this work 10 years ago as a freshman in college. My college provided a program called Prison Outreach, where it was a weekly tutoring program in local jails and prisons where we did GED and ESL tutoring. And I think what drew me to the program is I think prisons and jails are by design built in such a way to be out of mind and out of sight. And I think that it's really important for us to try to be more proximate with these institutions, because by design, they're built to prevent that proximity. So Father Greg, who runs Homeboy Industries, where I have the privilege of working for the next 2 years, always says that it's only by standing at the margins that we can begin to erase the margins. And I think, again, prisons by design are constructed to be at the furthest margins of our society and to place people who have already been marginalized further away from our collective consciousness. So I think just the fact of being present in that space has been really important for me.
In the 90s, I was involved with the Homeless Writers Coalition in Los Angeles and taught middle school in Compton, California, and K through 12 in Highland Park in East Los Angeles. And in all of those contexts, I became very aware of the centrality of the justice system in individuals' lives, in the community lives, in family lives, and the issues of incarceration and of policing in communities. And then in the following decade, I was teaching or working in writing instruction at a community college and worked with many students who were dealing with probation and parole and history of incarceration, and saw how that impacted their lives and the lives of their communities and their families. So all of those led up to my wanting to be involved in education in the criminal justice system. And then fast forward to 2012, I had a neighbor and friend who took a job teaching at the Penitentiary of New Mexico. She is here today, Sally Benson, and is an educator that I have great admiration for, whose students were really impacted by her teaching there. And when she described what she was doing and the challenges and the gratification and the incredible power of her work, I wanted to do that, and here I am.
Quinn and I come from the same department, and so I read the same email from Dr. Bogus. It's a pretty good email. it's something I never thought about before. I'm not sure how much difference it can make or will make or does make, but for a few hours a week, it certainly was worth trying. I'm glad I did it.
I also was recruited by an email. Last year, I heard from Corey and Joe Lockhart that they were looking for an instructor to teach psychology because it was a requested course at the prison. I hadn't known that this was even an available opportunity at ASU until I got that email, and I jumped on it pretty much the second that I could, and have had a really good time developing that course. In my own research in social psychology, I'm interested in the experiences of underrepresented students in educational contexts. So I see as this opportunity is kind of a way for me to enact what I've learned about encouraging belonging and learning in classroom contexts in a very challenging but also rewarding environment.
First, let me apologize for my informal dress and overall appearance. Today at ASU, the College of Public Service and Community Solutions had our day of service, and so this morning I was out cleaning up alleys in Phoenix. So do not hug me, and I apologize. My program is a little bit different, and so again, I teach the Inside Out Prison Exchange Program. It's a national program that was developed at Temple University in 1997. We're doing it for the first time here in Arizona. And so the way that we're different is that we bring ASU students into the institution to learn alongside incarcerated individuals. And so some of my students are here. They're at the far table over there. They're in black and white shirts. They too cleaned alleys this morning, so don't hug them either. But I encourage you to go speak with them at some point and get some of their experience and some of their insights into what this class has been. But again, it's a little bit different, and so again, it's ASU students learning alongside incarcerated individuals. And so the reason that I got involved with this, one is when I first experienced interacting with incarcerated individuals, it opened my eyes, and I'd love to provide that opportunity for our ASU students as well. Again, I think if you talk to them, you'll see pretty quickly that it's had quite an impact on them, and it's given them a lot of passion for what they want to do later in life. Second, my research is always about reducing recidivism, and I think programs like this can help. Some of the guys in our class, they've been in for 15 years and they haven't spoken to a civilian in that entire time. And so they're talking to officers and they're talking to other people that are incarcerated. They're not talking to civilians. And just about all these guys are going to get out again. And so I think we want them interacting and speaking with people on the outside.
I was also recruited by an email from Dr. Wells and Joe Lockhart. But I also, coming from the creative writing program, other students before me had pioneered, been doing this stuff. Several people had been going down. I knew several older students who had been doing courses down at Florence. So even before I got the email, people were sort of talking about it and saying how rewarding it was and how great of an experience it was. So I sort of had my eyes open for it. And then when it came, I jumped on it.
My experience is similar to Gary's. just hearing very good stories from people in the creative writing program that had done it before, but then also having the opportunity to teach creative writing. As graduate students, we often teach composition and sometimes creative writing, but that's a love that I really have and wanted to share where it was needed. So I kind of jumped on that. I was looking for other voluntary opportunities, but to take my talents to a place that could actually be applied and make a difference is why I ended up doing it.
Thank you, guys. It sounds like you all come from a wide background, but you all serve such a great purpose. And some of you have also said the key word of rewarding experience. I was wondering if, and anyone can take this question, or you all can, if you can kind of elaborate on what those rewarding parts are, what has been the most rewarding part of your teaching.
The mic got passed to me, so I'll go first. The entire experience has been very rewarding. I think one of the speakers on the last panel said it was strange when you say that this is the thing that you do and people look at you like you're crazy. Because, you know, after a few months of teaching, I was able to say, oh, yeah, you know, and on Fridays, I teach intro to psychology at the prison, and people would look at me and go, oh. And I was like, no, it's great. It's really great. The best part about teaching, or the most rewarding part, I would say, so far is seeing my students gain confidence in themselves and really begin to think like researchers. We're teaching a science-based course, and to have students come back and say, oh, well, couldn't you test it this way, or have there been any studies that have looked at this problem, really just seeing their curiosity and their willingness to ask questions has been really inspiring.
Yeah, same for me. The best part of teaching is that when students learn, notice seeing they'll struggle with something, then suddenly it's, oh, I get that now. And it's just the, teaching at ASU, teaching in prison, middle school, high school, it's all kind of the same. They get it, and it's just a great feeling. It's one of the best jobs ever.
When asked what's most rewarding, I always think of individual students and individual accomplishments of those students. But also, we're given an opportunity in an environment that's incredibly dehumanizing to treat individuals with respect and with dignity, to accord them that on a day-to-day basis, and that is a huge, huge reward.
Yeah, I'd say the most rewarding part were the rare and small, but certainly existing moments of resistance and transgression that this job provided. Distorted thinking. I don't think we can talk about distorted thinking without talking about a distorted world. I don't think we can talk about distorted thinking without talking about communities of concentrated poverty that are there by deliberate policy decision and design. We can't talk about distorted thinking without talking about structural racism, without talking about racialized policing, without talking about racialized prosecuting. All of us have distorted thinking patterns, but only some of us end up incarcerated because of a mistake that we made that stems from a distorted thinking pattern. And more often than not, those who end up incarcerated because of supposed distorted thinking mistakes are people of color and people who are born in low-income communities. And I just don't think that we can approach we have to be honest about the fact that we've made a societal decision to address those structural problems by then caging the very people who are most affected by those issues. And then to try to address that issue by telling those people who are now warehoused in cages that their thinking is distorted, to me, is not a solution. And so in the very small openings that I had while I was teaching, I tried to take those openings. So at the level 2 facility at PNM, there was a little bit more flexibility in terms of the programming that we did. For those of you who aren't familiar, the penitentiary of New Mexico is 2/3 maximum security and 1/3 minimum security. The maximum security is your classic panopticon designed, highly surveilled facility where there's you're constantly being watched. The level two facility, there's less monitoring. So at the level two facility, another AmeriCorps member and I started a group once a week that we called Current Events. And it was open to anyone who wanted to come. And we always had 7 to 15 guys who would show up once a week, and we would pick an article, and we usually picked an article that had to do with some issue related to criminal justice or to mass incarceration, and we just had a space where people could talk about it. And I think that was the most rewarding thing for me, was for there to be an acknowledgement in this extremely oppressive institution that's designed to be oppressive, that it's not all a question of personal responsibility and personal accountability. And there are larger structural issues that are driving who ends up in these facilities. So that was the most rewarding part of my experience for me, was to be able to hold that space with the students and to be able to validate, I think, what they knew already. But for that to be spoken out loud in that environment was extremely rewarding.
I have one great reward to talk about, and I have a weekly reward. The weekly reward is when we finish tutoring the students after 2 hours, they say, thank you, and have a nice weekend. I think it's great that they tell us that. But the most rewarding was we do a mandatory eighth grade tutoring. And so can you imagine going to a class where people have to be there? But we found out that right after spring break that everyone that we've been working with last semester up to spring break had graduated. They passed their eighth grade test. We were so excited. So we have brand new faces now to work with. So I think that's very rewarding, that what we're doing is really paying.
Oh, this mic works now. We got it. We have two mics now. I think one of the most rewarding things for me, obviously, when we go into the classroom, our students are not shy about telling us how grateful they are that we're there. They're very vocal about it. On the first day, they told us, you know, you're safe, which was, like, they all said that, I think, when they were introducing themselves to us, which was, you know, I think rewarding in a way that they cared that much to say that. But it was also rewarding for me to, like, wake up in a way, because I don't think I was aware of so many things that were going on, so many things that were happening. Somebody earlier, I forget who, and I apologize, but said out of sight, out of mind, and I think that's very, very true. And I led my life for, you know, 20 some odd years with it being out of sight, out of mind, not something that I ever thought about. So for me, one of the most rewarding aspects is just getting to be aware of it, getting to do my part to spread awareness, to make some sort of change because of that. And I definitely think I've also learned more from these students than I ever had from any other classroom that I've been in. They teach me probably, I really do mean it when I say they teach me more than I teach them, like legitimately. So other classes, I think I teach them a little bit, but these guys have taught me so much in so many different ways, and so it's been really rewarding like that, I think. Yeah.
I'd also like to add, we team teach together, so we cover both fiction and poetry in our classes, but I think the especially rewarding moments are just during class when we're having deep, intelligent conversations about the reading that we're covering. They're connecting to the authors, they're beginning to think in more complex ways, and it really reflects in their writing. We've had several opportunities where they've been able to submit to literary journals, and for one of those submissions, one of the students was considering not putting in a certain poem, and I was like, no, you should put this one in. And that was one of the poems that was accepted. So, like, really, getting to see, like, that their words do mean something, that they have the opportunity to be published or at least considered. That was Cream City Review, which is a pretty big deal, especially for an inmate to publish, and even, you know, even us to publish in. But then also serving as editors on Iron City Magazine has been another way that we've been able to connect with inmate writing, not just in with the student group that we work with, but outside that.
My first answer was the transformation, seeing the confidence grow. But I started to think a little bit more about it, and this provides a forum to kind of address some of the larger issues that we experience as researchers and students. If you look around today, you've got a full room here today of people that are listening to this. And I believe we have a responsibility as educators and as students and as researchers to bring awareness to some of the larger issues associated with incarceration. And I think there's more and more people that will listen when you start talking about education and teaching in prisons. And that's an opportunity to do some larger things.
Thank you all. I'm so blown away by how much respect you have for your students and how you put them, their needs first. I think that's the mark of a great educator. I just wanted to applaud you all for that. If only teaching in prisons could be wonderful all the time. I realize that there are a lot of challenges and obstacles that you guys face. So how do you navigate the challenges that arise from working with incarcerated students and within the prison system? Whoever wants to go first.
Well, it's not a job for anyone who can't handle disappointment and who can't handle things being changed perpetually, who has expectations that you're going to go in and your day will go a certain way. And like all teaching, I don't think there's any teaching where you don't encounter despair. Whether it's a kindergartner or a middle schooler, you will always encounter students who are going through things that you cannot touch, and all you can do is help them by teaching them. And that is the case in the prison to perhaps a greater degree than anywhere else, but it's the same as any teaching job. And yet the rewards are so great that you're able to want to get up in the morning and do it.
Yeah. Prisons are traumatic spaces. And again, I'm sorry, I'm like a broken record, but they're designed to be traumatic spaces. And the majority of our students, the data shows that they're coming from experiences of trauma. And so incarceration is just compounding the trauma, because incarceration itself is a traumatic experience. And as an educator in that space, I think it's really important to acknowledge the vicarious trauma that we take on being in those spaces. And so I always come back to this guiding Audre Lorde quote that she has, which is, self-care is not self-indulgence, it's self-preservation, and that's an act of political warfare. So every part of that quote had a lot of meaning for me and continues to have meaning for me. I still go into prison spaces once a week. I just think it's really important for us, if we want to tear down this system, to acknowledge that it is hurting and harming all of us who interact with it, because the scale of incarceration has gotten so large that it's hard to find someone who isn't directly impacted, who doesn't have a family member or a friend or neighbor who has been incarcerated prior. And those of us who choose to work in those spaces, especially, you know, people like Leah who are there full time, especially when you're there full time and you have the choice to leave at the end of the day and the choice to come back every morning, you carry a lot of trauma with you. And I'm still working through that. 4 years later, after leaving PNM, I'm still working through the effect that it had on me. I was talking about earlier how it's designed like a panopticon. So when I was one-on-one with my students at the maximum security site teaching at the door, I knew that at any given moment I could be being watched, but I never knew when I was actually being watched. And again, that's by design. And so I was always like jerking back to try to see if someone was watching me or not. And just physically, I have a lot of tension in my back that I'm still working through. And that's not talking about, you know, the vicarious trauma that I carry and that those of us who enter these spaces carry, in no ways is meant to, I don't mean to be callous, because of course it doesn't compare in any way, shape, or form to the trauma that folks who are incarcerated face. But I think that it is helpful to acknowledge that everyone who interacts with these structures comes away changed for the worse, and that there are real physical consequences to this work. And it's not a coincidence that corrections officers have sky-high rates of suicide, of domestic violence, of alcoholism, of substance abuse. Everyone who, this system is toxic for everyone who interacts with it. And so another quote that I come back to a lot is an Adrienne Rich quote. I always get it wrong. So it's, there must be those among whom we can sit down and weep and still be counted as warriors. And I was really lucky that my boss was Michelle Ribeiro, and she was someone like that for me. And I think it's very, very important to find those people when you're doing that work. And it's also important for us as educators in these spaces to think about creating that space in our interactions with our students. How can we both be that person for each other that create that space where it's okay for us to weep and still be counted as warriors, whatever that means. And I have, you know, problems with that term, but however you choose to define it. And that's a really challenging task in the hyper-surveyed environment that are prisons, but that's something that helped me, was being deliberate about trying to create those spaces of reflection and safety.
If you would call it a challenge, in our classes, there are approximately 20 students, and there are maybe five tutors that help us. The students range in age from, say, 18 to 88, all ages there. So some of the students just got a high school diploma. Some did not finish high school. Some have college degrees, all mixed together. So for the persons who've had eighth grade math before, it's almost an insult to them to sit there thinking that I have to relearn this that I've learned before. So when we go in, when we talk about a particular subject, we work a problem together, and then I assign problems to each table, and then we get a person from each table to explain the problem that they did. And initially, there were a few people who were just, I'm not going to talk. So I would leave them alone, but I would come to them and ask them quietly, how's that problem? Did you work that one? And they may say something to me that they wouldn't say out loud, but eventually we won them over, and they also would respond and talk about the problems that they did. So the challenge started, but we finished. They finished working. So I really, really love what I do.
Yeah, just to echo Queen's statement, this is maybe more practical than the question was meant, but the biggest challenge for us at the South Unit, every student's different. Some students haven't passed eighth grade. Some students have passed, graduated college. And so it's kind of hard to get a coherent sort of a class discussion going, because two people can discuss a certain topic, the rest can't. So for us, it's been a lot of individualized instruction, trying just to circulate, talk to them individually as much as possible. But it can be tough. Just the backgrounds are just incredibly, incredibly different from eighth grade to college graduates, and everything in between. Another challenge, again, I've only done it for a few months, but there's an issue with, I think it was in Kingman, and so they're transferring prisoners. You have no say in that, but students you worked with for 3 months and you were seeing really good progress, and suddenly they're not there anymore. And so then last semester someone was going to take the GED. We, you know, we helped them a little bit to learn that, and then I don't know how that went for them, you know, because they got transferred away. And so change always happens, different backgrounds. You just kind of do your best with it.
I'd like to echo that also. We teach in a minimum security unit, in the North Unit at Florence. And so a lot of our students actually have additional responsibilities in the prison, either in the prison or they will also work sometimes outside. So just it's a challenge to have to be flexible as an instructor that, you know, one day we may have 100% of the students there and another, you know, we went to class yesterday and we only had four of our students and just kind of, going forward and then trying to ensure that we don't end up leaving anybody behind that way. We haven't had anyone else transfer, but yeah, just kind of getting used to the ebb and flow of who's going to be there in a given week.
I would say the biggest challenge is you have to be on your A game at all times as an instructor. I've taught at the college level for 10 years now, and you can slide by being a little unprepared at times, but not when you teach in the prison. Those students will tell you, we drive down an hour and 15 minutes in a van down to the prison, and I'm in a zone. I'm not talking. I'm looking straight ahead. I'm getting prepared. Because you'll be held accountable for everything that you say and you do by guys on the inside. Everything that you write, you have to be very deliberate. You have to know that you'll be accountable for that. Just to give you an example, we had a guy who's been in for 8 years or so, and he said that he had the worst night of sleep in his life, the worst night of sleep of his life in prison, because he didn't know what sentence fragments were or how to fix them. And on his paper, I had said, you have a lot of sentence fragments, you know, work on that for the next time around. And that was the response that I got. And so you have to be very deliberate. You have to think about what you're saying, what you're doing, and you're going to be held accountable, which is a very, very good thing.
Yeah, I would like to echo a lot of what other people have said already. We have also, one thing in our classroom that we've experienced is we've lost more than half of our students to Kingman. They were one day gone, and they don't know when they're leaving. So for the past month, there's been a huge amount of anxiety in our classroom because they don't know who's next. We show up and we ask, and two people are gone. And it's been like that for a month or maybe more, which has made it very challenging for us to teach then, because we have students who have been there with us since the beginning and who were there doing creative writing classes before that, so they're very advanced. And then they're trying to fill out our numbers, and there are people who want to be in the class, but then they're coming in and we have to start over for them. So how do you reconcile those two things? How do you not bore the people who are ahead? How do you, you know, not leave behind the people who just started? So that's been a really challenging thing, and I think that's, you know, you have to bring your A game for that, because it is challenging to find that space, and it's been difficult to work through that, I guess. That's probably been one of the most challenging things recently, at least, is dealing with that.
In addition to what Gary said, just sort of on smaller levels, being aware of how the classroom environment is different from when you're teaching at ASU, we learned pretty quickly that, like, you know, if you forget something in class, you can't send an email to say, like, oh, don't forget about this. So, like, coming prepared, like, everything written out, if you're going to, like, have an assignment prepared for someone, you know, being aware of that, and also how much paper you provide, like, providing all that reading material and assignments on paper adds up, and then collecting that and not wanting to waste time doing that in class when you could be teaching or using that time better. I think the transferring to the new prison has been the most difficult, because you can see how this class, and they remind us every time, like, how meaningful it is to them, and it's sort of like a big unknown, like, moving to a new prison, they don't know, you know, if creative writing will be offered, how they're going to continue with their work, and a lot of them are working on really great things.
I just want to tag on to that. One thing is the challenges for them, which is paper is not free, pencils are not free. Like, these things that they want to use, they have to earn, they have to work for them, and they're very expensive to them for what they can do. So we have students who are, you know, they're giving us 20 and 30 page stories, and we're saying, all right, now revise it. And they can't go and retype it. You know, they've written it by hand, so that means they have to get another 30 pages, right? They have to get another pencil, they have to get another pen. These are challenges for them. They're things that they have to overcome that we have no idea about. And they don't have, you know, staples, they don't have paper clips, they don't have these very basic things that I think we take for granted. They don't have, you know, some of them have folders, but most of them don't. Like, so the challenges for them, I think, have also, in a way, been challenges for us and in understanding the things that they're dealing with so that we can not, you know, be ignorant and do what's best for them.
Thank you all. And I asked this question about the challenges, not to discourage anyone or to bring down the mood, but I asked so that, you know, we can identify challenges and work to improve them. So my last question for you all, I think, is the most important question. How can we continue, grow, and improve educational programming in prisons?
I think it has to start with people who want to do it. The volunteers are people who want to work in the prisons. And I think as long as they want to do it and they get rewarded by doing it, I think it will grow. And somehow begin or start respecting your students. Your students have to have that respect, because it's like a revolving door. You respect them and they respect you. And that will grow, and then more people who volunteer will do the same, and I think the system will increase. That's what I think.
I think we have to be explicit about education being a tool for liberation and transgression. And to me, that means integrating fields like ethnic studies, gender studies into education curriculums. And I know that's probably, especially in Arizona, that's a controversial statement. But I think those are the curriculums that students connect with the most, because they explain their lived realities and they explain the structures that are working against them. More broadly, I think that we all need to commit to doing the imaginative work of how to tear down these structures as they currently exist. And I think a big part of why we have been limited in doing that is that these structures have become so normalized in our day-to-day lives that we are limited imaginatively in how to even envision something different. And I think it's really important to remember that prisons did not always exist, you know, that the world was not created with prisons already there, that they are something that we created, and they're a choice that we made in terms of how to deal with certain societal issues. So I think as educators, it's important for us to take that task on ourselves, but more importantly, to enable our students to take on that task. So I don't really like the saying giving a voice to the voiceless, because I don't think anyone's voiceless. I think everyone has a voice, especially incarcerated folks have a voice, but I think their voices have been deliberately suppressed. And I think our job as people who are privileged to not be incarcerated is not to give a voice to the voiceless, but to find ways to amplify their voices that are already there. And I think programs like the Penn Project and different prison education programs are really, really exemplary models of how to do that, of how to lift the voices of folks who are the most directly impacted by these oppressive structures, because they're the ones they're the ones who should be leading this imaginative exercise, and they're the ones who should be leading our way forward.
I think I'm going to take this a little bit in a different direction, which may not be answering your question exactly, but as many things as I can imagine wanting to do teaching within the system that I'm not now able to do, I think that the real component is programs when people release. And all of the conditions for recidivism reduction that we looked at this morning, we're looking at changes that the inmate needs to make in himself. When those inmates get out and do not have housing and do not have jobs and there are not programs in place to enable them to reach those things, the people in this room might have a hard time finding jobs. The people in this room may be struggling in this economy. Those people are not going to be able to make that transition back into society unless we are actively providing them those kind of programs. And so that really isn't an answer to your question, but it's a very important part of
this. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm not going to be able to answer that question at all, but for me, just getting people to maybe realize that they've all made mistakes. I'm not even sure if mistake for some of these inmates is the correct word, because some of them have done some terrible, terrible things, but they're still people, they're still humans, and they're going to come out someday and try the best you can to help them be successful with it.
In terms of what we can do by expanding these educational programs, I was thinking, first of all, something that's really important will be expanding partnerships. So I'm really grateful to the folks at the prison complex at Florence who allow us to work with them, but I would love to see this become, you know, something statewide where we can, you know, work on developing those partnerships, and hopefully that's something that we can touch on later, would be how to inspire these partnerships in other places, but also offering more advanced courses in the places where we currently work, so that people kind of aren't doing a one-off educational experience but can see how it builds, would be really great. And also, I'm a little bit torn on this because I really enjoy how intrinsically motivated my students are to come to class, knowing that they're not coming there for anything other than their own edification. But I would love to see, if not actually getting some sort of credit for participating, at least a certification saying, I've completed Introduction to Psychology, something along those lines.
I think awareness is most important, and I know that's said a lot, and people are often critical that that's not enough, but I do believe that it's important. I've got information about our program up here if you want to learn more about it, but I do think it's awareness, and I think today with social media, you can do that a lot easier, and you can reach a lot more people very quickly, but you never know who's going to be tomorrow's correctional officer, or tomorrow's warden, or you know, somebody that can affect policy or make some sort of change. And so the more people that are aware of the benefits of having education behind the walls and the impacts that it makes, I think the better.
I'm not sure like how to spread education, but I think one thing that should definitely be considered is what type of education and what we're being offered. I mean, obviously, you know, I'm coming here with a bias because we teach creative writing, and but I think things like that, things like the arts, you know, a lot of us have taught at ASU or been at ASU, and you've seen a student when they like, you know, take a class, some sort of class, that all of a sudden they're awake. You know, they want to do that major, they want to follow that. It's something that they're passionate about and they want to do. And so I think one thing that's important is giving people something to be passionate about, you know, as to what that is, I have no idea, but I mean, giving people the opportunity to experience something that they can deeply care about. To me, that seems like something that would be incredibly valuable and a driving force, a motivator. So as to how that happens, I have no idea, but giving them the choice, giving them the option, I think could make some sort of difference.
Kind of going back to what was said at the other end of the table about giving inmates access to have their voice heard a little bit more, I think is so important. At least, I mean, our experience with the literary journals we've helped them to submit to, there are so few that still accept mailing submissions, let alone handwritten submissions. So Iron City Magazine, which Nate and Corey have really, you know, built this, does acknowledge that difficulty. And I think hopefully we'll really start getting some ground with the next issue and the next after that. And I think, I don't know, going forward, more classes, we're gonna really try to get other creative writers involved next year and the year after that, because we're heading out and our students are aware of that and they're like, well, is there gonna be something over the summer or next year? And we don't know at this point, but we're gonna try our best. So, involvement while you're here, seeking out opportunities for others to get involved, awareness.
Thank you all so much. Before we end, I'm going to open it up to a question from the audience, if there is one.
Yeah, I have a question.
Sure.
I'm an art teacher, substitute teaching in the district right now, and yesterday I was in a class of kindergartners who were using technology, right? Using technology to teach themselves. So middle schoolers are learning coding on programs that are provided. If we can do that for our kindergartners, why can't we do that for our students?
Exactly.
Well, at the high level security facilities, they don't have access. They can't have access to those.
To computers.
I'm not saying that it shouldn't be possible, but at the moment it's not.
I was going to say what she said. In our classroom, there are some old computers along the wall, but they only have certain programs in them. I've wanted to get them to do things, but they said, no, we can't do that. And to echo what someone said earlier, little things are very expensive in prison. Pencils and paper, I was astounded at how expensive they said they were. And they make less than a dollar an hour. I was just shocked. So they really can't afford a lot of things. I think security-wise is probably why they don't have the internet or anything like that in the prisons.
We might have time for one more question. Yeah, sure.
Can we throw in humor? Yes. If it's expensive for them, I'll go to Walmart and I'll buy things. Because I don't want everybody to have more things. A floor, something like that. People pay.
And also, we're having a book drive, a book donation right now. We have a box outside of Dr. Wells' office, and we're taking books. So if you want to.
Not
hardback books, but.
If you're on the ASU campus, I'd be happy to collect paper at my office and take it down there. Here's mine. Have a neighbor day. Anytime, please. Yeah. And pencils and basketball. No, they can be regular pencils. But not mechanical pencils.
Well, this is why we bring people together, so we can start things like this. On that positive note, please join me in thanking our panelist members.